Getting through a dull day at work is not always great, so why not find a little solace with some mesmerizing desk toys, or two, or four? We all probably have a favorite, so let's pick a few and explore not just the science behind how they work, but how scientists use those same principles to help run the modern world. Who doesn't love the steady metallic clacks of a Newton's cradle? And it's so easy to play with these balls. You just pick your choice of balls, lift them up, let them go, let the physics take it from there. That's not what I would have expected to have happen. Let's start out though, with just one ball. When it swings back to its starting point, it collides with that stationary ball, and that collision exerts a force that gets transferred all the way down the line to the opposite end of the cradle. And since the last ball has nothing to run into, it gets to swing out to basically the same height that you lifted the first one to, only to smack back down into its neighbor when gravity pulls it back. Altogether, this old toy is a go-to demo for a variety of basic physics concepts, from Newton's laws of motion to conservation of energy. But we're gonna zoom in and take a closer look. It turns out that while steel is pretty solid, even small collisions cause the balls to flex a tiny bit, making them behave like tiny springs. So even though a human eye might see the end ball kick upwards at basically the same time as the starting ball collides with its neighbor, the transfer of force is not instantaneous. Instead, the first ball compresses on impact and then expands to restore its shape, imparting a force on the adjacent ball, and so on and so forth. And the fact that you have this series of compressions and expansions moving through space means that you've basically got yourself an acoustic wave. Yeah, your Newton's cradle isn't just making a series of clicky-clack sounds when each ball hits its neighbor. Everything that happens between all the balls is basically the same as a sound wave. Now, what would happen if we tried sending an acoustic wave through our Newton's cradle? Well, it would transmit right through, but it would also get a bit distorted, similar to how sound passing through a wall gets muffled. That's because springs tend to vibrate at a very specific natural frequency, also called the fundamental or resonant frequency. And on the whole, they're better at transmitting that frequency more than others, so any sound waves that a spring is worse at transmitting will die off a lot more quickly. But a Newton's cradle doesn't just muffle certain sounds, it also creates extra ones, because a Newton's cradle doesn't just behave like a spring, it also behaves like a really weird spring. Maybe that was a bit rude of me. Scientists don't actually call springs weird. The technical term is non-linear. It basically means you need more complicated math equations to describe how they work compared to so-called linear springs. But that is where we connect our little desk toy to the real world, because nonlinear springs can have some pretty cool applications. For example, you can use them to focus acoustic waves, like a magnifying glass does with light waves. And back in 2010, some scientists at Caltech made a sort of two-dimensional Newton's cradle that could focus and fire what they called sound bullets. That sounds a bit dangerous given the name, but they were actually interested in improving people's health. Their setup was tunable, meaning they could create different kinds of sound bullets for different applications. And they highlighted two in particular. One was that sound bullets could act kind of like a souped-up sonogram, because a more focused sound wave would let a doctor get a crisper view of the inside of your body. Alternatively, sound bullets could be fired into the body in such a way that they could destroy a cancerous tumor without having to cut a person open. That sounds good. Also scary, though. So the next time your coworker gets annoyed at all the little clicky-clacks coming from your desk, tell them that you're working on the next breakthrough in medical acoustic technology. Next up, we have the gyroscope, another pretty straightforward mechanical toy that operates on classical mechanics principles. All we need to do to get it going is spin that center rotor disc, because once it's spinning, no matter how I move the housing around it, the disc seems to stay pointing in the same direction. It's like magic. But it's not magic. Or if it is, it's magic that can be completely explained by the law of physics. For one thing, everything's set up so that there isn't too much friction between the individual pieces. That lets this axle here and this gimbal here rotate basically on their own as you move the outer structure. As for the disc appearing to mind its own directional business, it can only change direction if a torque or twisting force gets applied that will change the disc's angular momentum. And for anybody who didn't just have a high school physics lesson pop into their memory, because honestly I didn't, that's too far gone, angular momentum is like regular momentum, but for rotating masses, and it involves both a rotational speed and a direction of that rotation. But because both the gimbal and the axle in this toy have very low friction, it's super difficult to transmit a force from the outer structure to the rotor, and that means that you can't apply a torque, and the direction of the disc's rotation never changes. And because it doesn't change, that makes gyroscopes not just a mesmerizing desk toy, you can also also stick one inside of a larger object and use it to keep track of direction. Like, imagine you're a pilot doing a bunch of fun aerial maneuvers in an air show. No matter where you are in one of your many loop-de-loops, a spinning gyroscope will always be able to tell you which way is the wild blue yonder and which way is the ground. Or maybe you're a submarine pilot and your boss gives you a simple order to head north. You might want to pull out a compass, hoping to detect the Earth's magnetic field, but because you're sitting inside of a giant metal tube with a bunch of electronics everywhere, that signal can get distorted and point you in the wrong direction. Plus, the Earth's magnetic poles aren't in the exact same places as its geographic poles, so you also might not have the right heading if you forget to compensate for that. So instead, you can make use of a technology called a gyrocompass. Although to find north, those have to account for the fact that the Earth is spinning all the time too. Let's pretend this tiny desk toy could keep spinning for a full 24 hours. I spin it up and I set it here so that the disk is parallel to the table, but it will not stay that way. So the disk has a different perspective on directions than we do. It does not care where the ceiling or the floor is. It only cares about maintaining its alignment with respect to the greater universe, which the Earth is moving inside of. The only places where the disk wouldn't appear to move over the course of the day would be in the geographic north and south poles. So if I'm literally anywhere else, a simple gyroscope won't always point north if it is set to start off that way. Plus, the Earth is always moving through space because it goes around the sun. So after one full day, the gyroscope won't even be pointing exactly back at the north geographic pole either. Luckily, there is an easy solution. Unlike my gyroscope, a gyrocompass actually wants to apply a bit of friction. That means the gyrocompass can now feel the Earth move, and as the Earth rotates, it exerts a relatively constant torque, helping the gyrocompass point toward the north-south direction defined by the Earth's spin axis. Who would have thought that playing around with toys like a gyroscope could give you a little direction in life?
Pardonnez-moi si vous plaît. Now, if you don't know what I just said, you could find out with the help of Babbel. Babbel is the number one language learning app in the world, with 14 different languages at your fingertips, including French, which I just spoke flawlessly, obviously. But if I messed it up, it's because I haven't gotten that far in my Babbel French lessons yet. But don't worry, I will get there soon, because the time commitment is just 10 minutes per lesson. So even with my busy schedule hosting SciShow videos and making SciShow videos, I can start speaking French in just 3 weeks. And sure, I might not have perfected my accent just yet, but that's something I can work on. And Babbel is a no-risk commitment, with a money-back guarantee in the first 20 days, so you don't lose anything for trying. And you can get up to 60% off when you sign up using the link in the description down below. Thank you to Babbel for supporting this video, and let's get back to it.
Hopefully your head isn't spinning too much yet, because this next toy is a personal favorite of mine. The drinking bird might just seem as mechanical as the last two toys, but actually it keeps moving thanks to thermodynamics. Liquid inside of the desk toy is something volatile, like methylene chloride. And that might sound like it's something super dangerous or inappropriate for a desk toy, but volatile just means that even applying a little bit of heat leads to a lot of evaporation. By dipping the bird's beak into a glass of cool water, you create a temperature difference between the head and the tail bulb. And if you have a temperature difference, that means you also have different evaporation rates and different amounts of gas pressure. It's that extra pressure that forces the liquid in the tail up this little tube toward the head. And as that liquid rises, the center of gravity changes, causing the bird to tip. But as the bird tips, the liquid shifts just enough for the pressure to equalize across the whole bird, making the liquid flow back out of the head, and everything starts over. We can see from our bird friend here that it is possible to seemingly create motion from nothing. But in reality, it is a temperature differential across the bird that is creating the motion, converting thermal energy into kinetic energy. And to take it a step further, that kinetic energy can be converted into useful electric energy, creating what we know as a generator. For example, in 2024, a team of researchers published a paper wherein they built a small proof-of-concept electric generator that relied on their version of a drinking bird to get things going. It only managed to output a small amount of power, 40 microwatts, but that was 13 times better than previous experiments had managed with a similar setup. So while this bird might be drinking on the job, he is also working hard to inspire some valuable engineering. Last but not least is possibly the most perplexing toy, the perpetual motion device. I mean, it's a fake perpetual motion device. Perpetual motion devices are not real. The laws of thermodynamics simply forbid it. Every loop of a theoretical perpetual motion machine must lose some energy. So if you want to keep this toy going forever, you've actually got to keep putting energy into the system somehow. Let's take a look at how one toy does this. Someone drops a ball down a ramp, and as it's going down, it seems to just maintain its momentum, and then it flies out the other side and is shot back up into a tray above the ramp with a hole in it. The ball falls through the hole to start the whole cycle over and over and over until the heat death of the universe or I get tired of the sound that it makes. Now, in an ideal world, conservation of energy would allow the ball to make it back to its starting location. But in the real world, friction always steals a bit of energy. So instead, this desk toy cheats with a little help from magnets, also with help from the fact that the ball is metal. Hidden in the base of the toy is a battery-powered circuit that activates a little electromagnet to pull on the ball for just a moment as it approaches the lowest point of its path. This gives the ball a little speed boost. So long as the electromagnet turns off just before the ball begins its upward climb, the ball will continue to lose energy from friction, but still have enough left over to make it back to where it started. And to know exactly when the electromagnet needs to do this little pulse, the circuit emits a separate pulse to give the ball its own small electromagnetic field that a sensor can pick up. But these electromagnetic pulses are not just used in toys that pretend to violate the laws of physics. They're also used in a bunch of important technologies that you can find everywhere from under a super speedy train to inside your wallet. It all comes down to the relationship between electrical currents and magnetic fields. A changing magnetic field can create currents in another metal object, which can, in turn, create even more magnetic fields. This is called electromagnetic induction, and it's how we create magnets out of seemingly uninteresting hunks of metal. And for technology like magnetic levitation trains, electricity is used to both create and modulate magnetic fields that levitate the train.
But you know what else uses it, assuming it has an RFID chip?
Your credit card. Let's say you want to pay by tapping your card against a little scanner instead of doing the whole insert and then it beeps at you, or you swipe it and it doesn't work. When you hold your card up to the reader, the machine sends an electromagnetic pulse to the chip inside the card. Then, thanks to induction, a circuit inside that chip gets enough energy from the pulse to emit a response pulse with a very specific pattern. It's basically an encoded version of your credit card number that can only be read in a very close proximity to the scanner and only when an electromagnetic pulse is emitted first to the chip. Then a sensor inside the scanner will confirm the pattern to make sure it's unique to your card before charging you. It may seem like magic that we could make trains levitate or read credit cards just by waving them near a scanner or have a tiny toy defy the laws of nature, but it's all just electromagnetism at work. Between the laws of motion, of thermodynamics, and of electromagnetism, these simple desk toys are not so simple.
And at least to me, that makes them all the more mesmerizing. I should probably get a Newton's cradle that doesn't have one of them broken. We lost a ball, that's all I'm saying.